Good morning. My name is Thomas Harter, and I am proud to introduce our second panel. We will move from water supply to water quality. And I'm going to follow Alan's tactic here and program. And I'll leave you to the details of our esteemed panel members' biographies to the handout. But briefly introducing Michelle Selmon on my far left here. She is a senior environmental scientist and regional climate change specialist with the Department of Water Resources and is helping folks understand the impacts of climate change on their various projects. She's engaged with the Tulare Basin Watershed Connections Work Group, working on many different issues there. Welcome, Michelle. Maria Herrera with Self-Help Enterprises. She's a research and project manager. She's a community development manager. She's focusing on helping communities engage on their water issues. She's also on the California Water Commission as of 2 years ago. Welcome, Maria. Then we have Chuck Ahlem, who is the founder, co-founder of Hilmar Cheese, also runs a large dairy in the Hilmar area. I've actually had the honor of getting my feet wet on California farms at his brother-in-law's dairy farm about 20 years ago. And he was Undersecretary of Department of Food and Agriculture in the Schwarzenegger administration, and he's president of Dairy Cares and the California Dairy Council. Welcome, Chuck. And then we have Professor Karl Longley, our local boy here, Fresno State, former Fresno State professor, engineer, long-term member of the Regional Water Board and chair of the Regional Water Board for the last 12 years, working on a diversity of water quality issues. Welcome to this panel. This is going to shift gear a little bit. We're going to be talking about groundwater and surface water quality in the San Joaquin Valley. And I wanted to start out, like Helen did, with where do you see our challenges in the San Joaquin Valley and the opportunities to meet those challenges as we're moving forward addressing water quality issues and natural habitat issues, ecosystem issues here in the valley? Michelle.
Great, thank you. Well, certainly there are tremendous opportunities that are coming forward on the horizon. You know, you heard this morning a little bit about the potential for retiring active farmland, the acknowledgement that with the changing water conditions, up to 500,000 acres of land could come out of production, which is certainly a hard thing for growers to hear. And yet, if that's the reality, the question is, what do we do with that land? If it's just fallowed and sort of ignored and left to the side, there's missed opportunity there to potentially restore habitat for common species as well as threatened and endangered species. And that would, you know, benefit things that are already listed as well as preventing further listings in the future. And so the agricultural community and the landowners and growers out on the landscape are going to be very important, I think, for finding some solutions that not only bring the region into balance with regard to water supply and water use, but also take some steps to bring habitat back to a region that has been highly altered. We've lost over 90% of most of our different habitat types, whether you're considering wetlands or even upland habitat, dry land habitats for species. So if there's a way that we can use both potentially temporarily idled lands as well as long-term fallowed lands to rectify some of that, I think that's a win-win all around. And so it needs, it's a situation that requires a lot more coordination and trust between those folks on the ground and the regulatory agencies and other land managers, but it's definitely something we now have incentive to do moving forward.
Maria?
As most of you know, here in the San Joaquin Valley, we have, you know, a lot of communities, primarily rural, small communities that are facing significant water challenges, not just, you know, with the lack of safe drinking water due to contamination, but also a number of communities, especially during this drought period, completely lost their supply of water. And so even though we are, you know, coming out of, you know, this drought, there's still a number of households here that today do not have, you know, running sources of water. They are still either relying on interim household water tanks that, you know, are supplying hauled water, or they are still connected to a neighboring well using either a garden hose or, you know, half-inch PVC pipes while they're waiting for the long-term solution. I think there's a lot of opportunity here, especially in light of the current administration's focus that it's given to small communities and addressing their human right to water. There's been a significant amount of funding allocated primarily for small communities, not just to address their lack of safe water, but also to improve engagement of these stakeholders in regional water management efforts, such as the Sustainable Groundwater Management Act, Integrated Regional Water Management Programs. And so both of these programs create a very unique opportunity for DAC stakeholders to develop partnerships, not just with other communities that are facing similar challenges, but most importantly with, you know, their neighbor, which is the agricultural industry, and look at opportunities to develop solutions that create benefits on both sides.
Thank you. It's a great opportunity to be here, but I think the collaboration is so critical and working together. I spent the last 20 years, 25 years working in collaboration, trying to, we've gotten past the attitude, I think mostly about those dam regulators, you know, where people used to say they're just an adversary, they're going to create problems. Well, now in the dairy industry, we really have a attitude of collaboration. If we have a problem, how can we solve it? But if we don't have the solution, how do we get that solution? Who pays for the solution? And I think we've made some tremendous progress in a number of areas. We're going to continue that. But without the appropriate collaboration, cooperation between people, and that's not only producers or our neighbors, the kids that are playing, we want to see them in a healthy environment. Now we want to see our families with a real strong, healthy environmental future with California. And so, therefore, I think working together, trying to solve these problems, and you know, and then together trying to find the dollars, what it's going to take to really get to the end and find a solution for some of these issues.
Thank you, Chuck. Karl?
Well, Chuck, I fully agree with you. We have to be able to learn how to collaborate better, and I thank you for your efforts in that area. I might point out that Chuck and I served together on a regulatory board for 1 year, so that was my introduction to Chuck, and really he is a collaborator and learns how to work together. That it's important. But big thing on my plate now is salt and nutrient management planning. We're beginning a series of hearings day after tomorrow on Thursday at Rancho Cordova office. These hearings and this work on salt and nutrient management plan will continue for about a year until when we adopt the final basin amendment to the basin plans in the Central Valley. This work started in 2006, and it's taken this long, but it's been a stakeholder effort. And you're going to hear at the hearings, you're going to hear people really still having a lot of concerns about various aspects of it. Of the basin plans, and the collaboration is so big to try to accommodate people's views and make sure they're heard and come up with something that will withstand a challenge down the road. In a more local concern, of course, is the whole issue that Maria brought up, and I don't think that we have really seriously address the issue of disadvantaged communities or those people that have a hard time for getting water. There's answers elsewhere. In the state of New Mexico, RCAC Rural Communities Assistance Corporation has been able to pull communities together to get scale, which tends to reduce costs. If you go to the Midwest, South Dakota, North Dakota, Iowa, Missouri, in that area, there are rural water agencies that deliver water to individual homes, to small communities, and mid-sized communities. And this is not on large pipes that's used for irrigation. It's simply for human consumption, and you can water your animals with it, typically. But I'm not aware that we've looked at that kind of approach here in California. We do have, not far from here, the Alto Water District. There's been an attempt to bring a number of small communities together under that, but there are so many bureaucratic hurdles to getting that thing in place that it's been a concept that's been worked on for several years without delivering a drop of water. So I think we need to go back and look at the kinds of barriers that are standing in our way, which I think are barriers that can be removed. People accomplish these goals elsewhere. I don't know what it's going to take to accomplish here. I think we have to work on that. Just one last thought. The big long-term issue in this valley, in my opinion, is salt. We bring in 2 to 7 million tons a year. The upfront issue on the salt nutrient management plan is nutrients, of course. That's nitrate, that sort of thing. But long-term, it's salt. If we don't solve the salt issue in this valley, we're going to find more and more farmland going out of production, and the economic impact of that is horrible. Thank you.
Thank you. I think we heard that there's several issues that are on the table. We have opportunities with respect to perhaps creating some habitat in exchange for the land that may have to be fallowed in order to meet our water supply demands. On the water quality side, both the nitrate issue, other drinking water issues, and salt are the big challenges. Organizing the communities. Maria, do you have any thoughts on Karl's point? There's other states, other places in this country that are doing better than we do with these rural communities. What do you see as the barriers that Karl mentioned that we need to identify to move forward? I know maintenance and operation of the water systems has been mentioned many, many times. Give us your perspective.
Well, first of all, I'd like to acknowledge that some of these collaborations that Karl is mentioning, you know, those conversations have started here in our area. And in fact, you know, there's been a number of systems that have consolidated to address both water quality challenges and also the technical, managerial, and financial challenges that these communities face. But we haven't done it to the larger scale that he is.
And talk a little bit, what are these challenges? When you're on the ground, you're the one that's out there in these communities. What are these challenges?
So obviously water quality is a big issue. There's a lot of communities that rely on single sources of water. So traditionally, you know, one well, when that well becomes contaminated, the district doesn't have the financial resources to just go ahead, hire an engineer, hydrogeologist, you know, address the problem. They really are at the mercy of public funding to both do the planning, the studies, and then to get shovel-ready projects and then go after construction dollars. So my experience in working with a lot of the communities is that it takes, you know, oftentimes a decade to get through the entire process before you can actually get to construction. And so throughout those 10 years, you know, you have this population of very low-income families paying not only very high water rates, because again, you know, the economies of scales are so small, but then they're also, up until recently, are also having to pay for alternative sources of water. And then you also struggle with, you know, getting enough people to be willing and able to serve on the governance structures of these small water districts, like public utility districts, community services district, and often mutual water companies that are not for profit. And so when they hit emergencies, it's really difficult for them to respond. I mean, something as simple as your pump burns out, you again are sort of at the mercy of the state. Is there emergency funding that can help you? Because again, you don't have a healthy reserve. So those are some of the challenges that you know we've been working on to address. And there's been a number of studies that have been funded here in our area to look comprehensively at how many communities are affected. Are we talking about 1, 10, 20, or are we looking at more than that? And so a few years ago, we looked at the Tulare Lake Basin Disadvantaged Community Study, looked at the DAC water challenges on a 4-county basin area, the Tulare Kern Hydrological Region. And we actually learned a lot about the communities. We learned that we have, you know, over 500 and something communities in this four county area. Over 300 of them are, you know, either disadvantaged or severely disadvantaged. And a big portion of those systems have a water quality violation, primarily due to nitrates, arsenic, or uranium. And so through this process, we not only learned about the challenges, but we sort of initiated more formally those discussions about how do you address these issues on a, you know, in a collaborative fashion? How do you begin to promote shared solutions such as consolidation of water systems or doing managerial consolidations where it's just not possible to connect a system because it's costly? And so I think that those studies created the foundation for communities to learn about each other. I think there was a lot of a lot of meetings that I attended and others here in the room where it was sort of the first time where these communities got to see themselves on a map and just see how close they were to each other and notice that they were facing similar challenges. And so I think some of that awareness and understanding that it's not just me, my neighbor also is facing these challenges, I think that's sort of one of the hurdles we have to address. But then also, of course, you know, our funding programs need to promote those sort of solutions. They need to incentivize consolidations between systems, between cities and smaller systems. I mean, as you all know, water politics is very difficult. And so sometimes, you know, there is a level of resistance from, you know, certain cities or communities from taking on others, and so you have to create the incentives for them to want to work together. And usually that is through, you know, promoting solutions that provide benefits for both parties. You know, Karl talked a lot about sort of this initiative in the north part of Tulare County and, you know, the partnership between the seven communities there and an Alta Irrigation District. And while I agree that, you know, this project has been studied for a long time, you also have to recognize that it takes a long time to move from the status quo. It takes a long, you know, again, there's a lot of education that has to happen. Funding has to come in place. And then also, you know, this is sort of a unique partnership where the ag industry, who doesn't, you know, really focus on providing water, is looking to play a role where they would be supplying water to these communities. And so you have to look at how do you help a group of communities go from, you know, relatively inexpensive groundwater to a more expensive source of water, such as surface water, because contamination is bad. How do you go from that, and how do you then create a solution that not just delivers safe water, but affordable water? And so I think those solutions create the opportunity to look at what contributions can the ag industry make. Yeah. Can they help not only through supplying water, but also maybe potentially subsidizing some of those increased O&M costs?
Maybe let me take that as a cue, Chuck. I mean, the dairy industry has been faced with this issue for a number of years. Back when I worked on the dairies 10, 15 years ago, some of those dairies were already at the time supplying some of their neighbors with drinking water. What are your thoughts on, you know, the broader issue of engaging farming? These are your communities as well. Engaging farming in this process of providing safe drinking water solutions for their communities.
I've heard a lot of dialogue the last few years about water, water use, water quality. Sometimes, you know, we can always pick out the standards. I said, at what point is water clean enough to drink? How much good water are we discharging that has all the attributes of good drinking water? What kind of filtration systems would be appropriate? We have our communities that need the clean water, but we spend more time regulating some of these things than we actually do trying to find solutions. So I think, with agriculture, we have an employee family base that we need to provide that drinking water. So people are looking, trying to see how can we better get water to these our farm workers, our community. Stuart deals with the issue down in his community where we talk about groundwater and availability of good drinking water. How do we as a state provide this water? It's not just a farming issue. It's not just a local community issue. It's a larger issue. And what are our social responsibility for a state and just living in this
country to provide the kind of drinking water that's needed.
Michelle, do you have any ideas, sort of from DWR's perspective, in being in the vicinity, you're surrounding some of these communities with some of the natural habitats, or perhaps in the future, as we go to convert some of these lands into natural habitats, are there opportunities to support these efforts in one way or another?
Yes, absolutely. I think that whether it's temporarily idling land from year to year during drought seasons, there's opportunity to provide habitat there by allowing it, rather than immediately going out and disking it to prevent species from moving in, allowing it to be fallow for a few years. There are safeguards that farmers can rely on to do that so that they won't be penalized in the future if something sensitive does move onto their property. I think one challenge is not being aware of those opportunities, and another is maybe some mistrust between the folks on the ground and the regulators, some fear there. So perhaps more communication and engagement and cooperation would have an effect with regard to short-term idling. I think the biggest opportunities really rely or lie with the long-term fallowing of some lands that can benefit not only wildlife habitat and the species that might inhabit that land, but also the landowner. If we can, you know, work towards creating a network of retired lands that provide habitat value that perhaps are not suitable for other uses such as solar, which was discussed earlier. Some lands might be ideal for that. Other lands are going to be better for habitat. Other land might be better for recharge. So it's a matter of working together on a regional scale and really seeing where those opportunities are for each of those types of land use, alternate land use, and connecting the folks on the ground that own that property and that can come together to find what their benefits might be. And the important thing to note is that that's not the kind of effort that has to start from scratch, at least not in the San Joaquin Valley, in particular in the Tulare Basin, which is the southern part of the San Joaquin Valley. A number of the wildlife organizations that are out there, including the Tulare Basin Wildlife Partners, have worked for years to identify the lands that would be most suitable for retirement and ultimately restoration for habitat and for other purposes as well. And the San Joaquin Valley Green Print is an effort that work to map lands that would be suitable for various uses, including open space, which ultimately benefit communities as well. I'll just quickly mention the Atwell Island Project, which was an interagency effort. Now that site is managed by BLM, or has been for many years. It provides habitat, it's retired farmland. It provided a pilot study for how to go about retiring land so that it doesn't just become a home for weedy plant species and pest species, but actually provide some value. There are some tools and techniques that can be used to do that effectively. That's a really good example. So we've already got a lot of planning efforts going on that could be drawn upon to create a regional strategy for retiring those lands. And then that there's still individual choice that would be a part of that process in terms of, you know, it wouldn't be a requirement. It would be the kind of thing people come together and decide the best places to implement those strategies.
Not to put you on the spot, but as part of this considerations, Alan earlier mentioned the map that's in the report showing sort of the recharge lands, and your agency being in charge of implementing SGMA just published a report on water available for recharge. So we're looking for recharge lands. We're looking for recharge lands, especially in this kind of times.
Right.
Has there been any conversations about potentially using these future habitats also as land for recharge?
Yes, absolutely.
Improving water quality in the process?
Sure. Thank you for bringing that up. Absolutely. UC Merced has recently done some research on the potential to flood actively cultivated agricultural land for short periods of time in years where we have, you know, like this year, a lot of water, kind of more water than we know really what to do with. And we previously thought of that water as a nuisance, you know, floodwaters, and now we really are shifting that dialogue to talk about stormwater management, recognizing that that's an important resource. So, you know, the research is in a fairly early stage, but is very promising in terms of the potential for ag land to serve a dual purpose of producing an active crop and getting revenue from that crop, as well as being a part of the solution for groundwater recharge. So we need to take those pilot studies that have been done and expand them and find new areas and see how it would work down in this part of the valley.
Let me change the direction a little bit. You mentioned CV salts earlier. We have the irrigated lands regulatory program. We have the dairy order. Sort of on the source side with respect to salts and with respect to nitrate, where are we? Where's the irrigated lands program? Where's the dairy order? Where's CV salts going to take us, Karl?
Well, CV salts becomes part of both the dairy order and the irrigated lands program, and quite frankly, becomes part of waste discharge permits for municipal dischargers. The program itself, of course, will show up in that form. I think, though, that once it is approved, the more exciting part for me, and I won't be around to see it because it'll extend for hundreds of years, but is that part that's addressing moving salt out of the valley. And it's called S-salt, strategic salinity, transport, something or other. I have a hard time remembering it, what the acronym means. But S-salt is the part of that program that will be implemented once we adopt the amendments. It's going to cost money, and just like with the programs we're talking about for disadvantaged communities, just like what we need to do for groundwater recharge, we need infrastructure. These are all infrastructure programs. We need to find ways of financing these outside of the traditional ways that we financed them. And I think that everybody has to be part of that because everybody benefits from it. We've talked about subsidence. We have canals that are becoming useless simply because of subsidence. Even where subsidence is not an issue, this infrastructure is aging. We've seen on Oroville what happens with old infrastructure if you don't put money into it. And it's going to require a very secure, very large source of funding, as I just said, that people do benefit from. Our livelihoods benefit from it. Our way of life benefits from it. So that's a tough question. Dave Orth and Laurel Firestone chaired a governor's committee that was to look at disadvantaged communities and how to solve their problems. And one of the major issues left on the table was the whole issue of how do you finance this. It's a hard nut to crack. It's one we're going to have to crack, though, if we're going to have a continuing economy in this valley.
Chuck, where is the dairy order going to take the dairy industry over the next 10 years? Are we going to be able to address and be innovative enough to deal with salts and nitrate coming from dairies?
I think it's going to be a continued adventure. I think what we know and what we did know, we're learning a lot in the process through our water monitoring program. We've got about 443 wells, 42 dairies throughout the valley, looking at what our groundwater issue with the regulation and the monitoring of our fertilizer that we put on, whether it be dairy manure or commercial fertilizer, comparing the uptake of plants to find out that, see what kind of balance. And we're already seeing improvements in those areas. So I think there's room for improvement, but we're really finding some interesting solutions in the process. So you throw this out, then you throw the new methane requirements, a 40% reduction in methane. People say, well, where is the world going to end? And I think if we're given time and we can really understand what the problem is, we can get there. But we got to have time, patience, and be willing to work on some projects that might fail. And not punish people if they put a project in and it fails to try to solve a problem. Yep. Because we have to work together to really find ways to deal with this salt problem. Well, we used to have a brine line. Karl talks about brine line, talked about a lot a number of years ago, and that was went into Kesterson. But the only trouble, they didn't bring it over into the bay to remove some of the salts. So we know that's not a solution, and it created some problems. So how can we find some maybe fairly simple solutions to deal with this problem? But the feeding of the cow, we really reduced the carbon footprint substantially by the way we feed the animal and we manage the dairies.
And are digesters going to be a big part of the solution, or are they going to solve all the problems?
They can be a good part of the solution. They're not economically feasible right now to do, but some dairies are getting real close to it. It's going to take some grants to make that function. But it is part of the menu that we're going to digesters, whether we have agronomic values or we can use that manure. We're actually short on some agronomic nutrients for our crops, so we can use all our manure on our facilities. But digesters is another part. Sustainable conservation is working on a worm bed to remove the nitrogen from the dairy waste. So it's through those partnerships, collaboration, and it's going to take some dollars. You talk about the solar issues there. The dairy industry, we've put in a couple megawatts of solar on our dairies, and just a little incentive will often help mitigate some of those, what they seem insurmountable problems.
Yeah. Karl, do you have any thoughts on from your side? You're kind of looking at it from the regulatory side. How do we engage our farmers on the irrigated lands program, on the dairy program? What is the progress they have made, and where do you see it going?
Well, I think they've made tremendous progress in the irrigated lands program. Certainly, if you look at, I'm most familiar with some recent data from East San Joaquin Coalition. If you look at pyrethroids, when they started off that program, they had all kinds of hits on pyrethroids that they had to put management programs around. Last year, they had one hit on pyrethroids. I think you're seeing that similar kinds of progress in various areas in the other coalitions. Insofar as digesters are concerned, once again, scale is important. Digesters, from an engineering perspective, are not the easiest things to manage. They can be very temperamental, very sensitive to what goes into them and maintaining the temperature at operating temperatures is critical. So it takes good operators, constant surveillance of the digester to have it work correctly. And I'm talking now about the above ground digesters. If we go to the advanced digesters of that nature, once again, scale is important. The more that can be some way or another operated together in this day and age, whether it's digesters or small water systems, they don't have to be connected. We already shown, and there's good examples, that in a small room you can operate a number of entities given the electronics we have today. But it's important to have that kind of management to be able to have good results.
Maria, what are your thoughts on sort of being working with these smaller communities that are within all of this farmland? Have you made enough progress? Where do you see the opportunities moving forward in working with the farming community and addressing some of the nitrate issues, some of the air quality issues?
First of all, I have to recognize that it's really hard to engage, you know, communities on some of the regional water management efforts or even the regulatory efforts when, you know, you're still focused on addressing the whether or not they're going to have safe water or whether they're going to have running water in their homes. But we have over the last few years seen, you know, a growing interest by the DAC stakeholders to engage in these efforts. And we are starting to utilize the Integrated Regional Water Management Program in SGMA to further advance, you know, cooperations between disadvantaged communities and the ag industry. Just last night, as a matter of fact, I was in Tulare at the Tulare Irrigation District Office facilitating a meeting for the Oakeyville Highland Acres Mutual Water Company, which is a newly formed entity that was formed to respond to the drought impacts in that community. So Oakeyville is about 100 homes community, low-income farm working community. They're about 5 miles west of the city of Tulare. Up until recently, well, currently still, they rely on individual wells, many of which went dry. And so we were able to assist them in getting some emergency funding to construct a system. But we didn't want to stop just there. We wanted to look at what else can be done to ensure that this community has a sustainable source of water that is safe and affordable. And so we've been looking at working with the neighboring irrigation district to see about potentially doing a recharge project up gradient from the community. There's already a basin there adjacent to the community that we has shown to preliminary, you know, improve water supply and water quality in the community. And, you know, most of the residents said, well, our groundwater level started declining once they were unable to put water in the basin. And so the interest grew very quickly when they heard that the irrigation district was potentially looking at establishing another basin north of the community. And so, you know, at the local level, we are seeing communities working together. We're seeing communities wanting to work with the irrigation districts, but also, you know, communities wanting to work more with the agricultural industry, both to look at ways to provide replacement water. We're working, Suffolk Enterprises is working right now on a pilot project with some of the folks in CV Salts looking at ways that we can pilot a program where we would be targeting people on private wells, sort of in the East Porter, in the Porterville area, and looking at ways that we can help those families get information about their drinking water, but then also help them, either by purchasing a point of use devices or replacement water. And so we are moving.
Where they have water quality issues.
They have water quality issues. And so we are, you know, moving in that direction of, you know, establishing more of those formalized partnerships. I think one of the things that I would like to emphasize, though, is, you know, as we make progress on the irrigated lands program, regulatory lands program, or on CV salts, or, you know, looking at projects that can benefit communities through an intervention from the ag industry, I think we really need to make sure that those negotiations and the development of the projects really include the communities themselves. Mm-hmm. I can't stress that enough, how important it is, you know, to make sure we're reaching out to the communities, make sure that they understand, you know, what's at stake for them, and that they have a say in how that partnership is established. And, you know, there's a number of organizations, such as self-help, that are working on, you know, educating communities on the importance and engaging in these discussions. And so I would say, you know, maybe a few years ago, we maybe weren't ready to have those conversations, but certainly we are now. And I'd like to, you know, see more of those direct conversations between the industry and the communities.
Karl, you wanted to comment on that?
Well, three quick observations. When folks sit down at the table, and I heard Maria talking about issues when groups that she works with sit down at the table. Earlier, I heard Eric Everett talking about those folks. Everybody sits down at the table. You got to realize they have real issues. And so often we think, well, one side has to win, the other side has to lose. No, we need winners and winners, and we need to find out how to make winners and winners sitting at that table. I think as I've been watching what's been going on, those folks that are working out there as mediators or whatever you title you want to put on them that can help those kinds of things take place, I think are very important people and are probably more important. I'm an engineer, probably more important than the design engineers to be able to get to final solutions that work for everybody. I really think that what you're going to see, one of the big points that's going to come up, I'm sure, is within the CV salts is one of the 12, 13 issues that has really been itemized is the whole issue on the management zones. And they're kind of like the GSAs. What do they look like? Well, what do you think they look like? And You know, it's. I think we have to define better what the management zones look like. And within that context, a good part of that is ensure that there is community involvement, that the individual communities can, no matter their size, can be brought into it and have their voice heard at the table. Then the third part.
If I can just interrupt, do you see some, is there going to be GSAs engaging as management zones?
Funny you say that. That was my third point. Okay. How these are integrated into the GSAs, I think, is critical. Because we don't want to have two warring groups of people out there, one representing the GSAs and the other is the management zones. And we haven't defined, nor do I think we really can define in the regulation how that happens. But at some point down the road, we're going to have to find out how that takes place. You know, the GSAs are responsible for water quality in addition to water supply. And certainly that's the water quality part of it.
And does that go for maybe the dairy order and irrigated lands program as well? Is there going to be more integration between them and what we're going to see with GSAs?
Maybe I think it's inevitable, but I'll let Chuck.
That's Mike, Carl. You know, I think it's going to take the collaboration to work together. But I think one thing I'd like to say is make sure, in order to solve these problems, we have to have a healthy business climate. Sustainable conservation operates off a motto: in order to have a healthy environment, you have to have a healthy business community. So how can we solve these problems together? In order to have a healthy business, I have to have healthy employees. I have to, this whole thing is intertied, but let's take these challenges one step at a time, not try to get too far ahead of ourselves. If we fail, back up and take another shot at it, but let's have some collaboration so we're not making the same mistakes again and again and again and just getting mad at each other and taking our marbles and going home.
And Michelle, I was going to ask you. You mentioned earlier, you know, this an opportunity here to use some of these farmlands, low value crop farmlands that may be going out of production into habitat. And we heard on the first panel there was some concern, you know, with respect to solar. On, you know, are we going to keep our water rights or not? Have people talked or addressed water rights issues related to the conversion of farmland into conservation?
I'll be honest with you, not that I've heard, and not saying that those conversations are not happening. I don't think that the process, honestly, is that far along for people to be considering that particular aspect. It's more about, you know, where, whose property, what will the impact be to an individual farm if lands are retired, and how to balance all of that. And so there's no easy answer, but those sorts of issues, those concerns need to be at that table that we're talking about, bringing folks together for coordination and collaboration. And so there are so many issues. So there's no single meeting or no single group that can address all of those issues. But you know, one example I just want to make sure that we have an opportunity to tell folks about, since this is really about water stress in the San Joaquin Valley and how to move forward, is thinking beyond just the valley floor, and also thinking more in terms of a watershed-based approach or a river basin approach. It's the kind of thing I'm hearing from more and more people that, you know, we really need to expand on the great work done by the IRWMs, the Integrated Regional Water Management Groups, and the collaborations that they've formed. They've really, you know, they've spent years working through their issues and challenges and convening groups of people that can talk about these sensitive issues, find common ground, not continue to argue over the things we know we disagree about, but then move forward. And so an effort that has formed in the last couple of years down in the Tulare Basin is the Tulare Basin Watershed Connections Work Group, which is advancing the work that the wildlife organizations have done in the last decades in the Tulare Basin, but also bringing in other partners, such as the Integrated Regional Water Management Groups and water managers involved with those, and also the forming GSAs. And also communities. We have some folks representing community of Alpaw, Community Water Center has been participating. So we're focused more, not so much on the salt issue or specific management opportunities for different operations, such as dairies or whatever the case may be, but thinking more about how we can have conversations about integrating the actions and strategies we identify that meet the needs of those particular entities, but that also provide, you know, ultimately the habitat benefit, because we're all benefiting from areas that remain in their natural state. You know, there are ecosystem services or nature's benefits, however you want to think of it as, but those have a tremendous benefit in terms of air quality, carbon sequestration, decreasing water pollution and dust kinds of issues, and providing recreational opportunities. These communities are dealing with, you know, a crisis situation of having clean water and accessibility to that. At some point, I think we hopefully will move past that and be thinking more about the general health of the young kids growing up in those communities and make sure that we have opportunities for them to get outside and connect to the natural world. And that's important, I think, for everybody on this panel and all the folks in the room, is to recognize the value for that. So bringing together, you know, groups that can incorporate those sorts of thoughts is going to be key.
So we covered a lot of ground. I wanted to open this up for questions from the audience. We have a microphone coming to you if you want to raise your hands. Stuart? Oh, you have a question back there? And then Stuart.
Hi, my name is Radley Reed. I'm sort of a local authority on Fresno County land use planning. And I'd like to introduce an idea to you that I have not heard expressed here. And that is the working relationship between local general plans and what SGMA is trying to do. Our current general plan of 2000 is a very forward-looking document for Fresno County. It contains programs and policies that are quite amazing in their their attempt to monitor and regulate groundwater quality and quantity. However, because of lack of funding and expertise at the county level, these programs are not being successfully implemented. I'm hearing rumblings now amongst county staff and electeds that they're very pleased that SGMA has come along, because I think they're thinking, we are not able to do this, maybe they can solve the problem. And what I'd like to tell you is, I think that's a wrong approach, because decisions are made at the local level, and they're going to affect everything that happens. They're made by local boards of supervisors and city councils. So it's going to be absolutely critical that whatever SGMA tries to do is reflected in the general plans of cities and counties. And just to finish up, I'd like to let you know that Fresno County is now going through an update of its general plan, and more importantly, a thorough update of its zoning ordinance, which is going to change the standards for development on all rural areas in the county. And I have not heard yet anybody going to the Board of Supervisors and saying, let's work together to make sure the programs and policies you put in place are going to work well for SGMA. Thank you.
You know, this brings up an interesting question. We've had the SGMA panel on panel one. You guys are working with the Irrigating Alliance Program, CV Salts, Drinking Water, Habitat. What about the connection to local land use planning? What about that interface between these programs, the Irrigating Alliance Program, CV Salts, the Drinking Water programs?
It's interesting. It's a very interesting question, and really not one that is within our realm as we, at the regional board level or at the state board level for that matter, as we go through our planning. But land use planning is such a critical part of it. I think that is obviously something that is. The legislature, I think, could best address how to link those together. It's important, but it's not one that we actually can affect in one way or any way or another, given the tools that the legislature has given us.
Chuck, you wanted to comment?
Well, land use planning isn't going to do any good unless we can respond to some of these issues that we have now. We've got to. Stuart mentioned this water in San Luis Reservoir. Why can't we just lay that across the farmlands and help and have immediate response to some of these problems? Unless we have a healthy business climate, I don't have any regulatory certainty. Can I still operate in California 10 years from now? That's what a lot of dairymen are looking at. They've total regulatory fatigue. Sure, we've had world-depressed prices and everything else. But we've got to just be able to, if we could get some quick response, whether it be from our federal agencies or state agencies, and say, hey, we got an issue. We've got some environmental folks that say, you know, this is a good idea. We got a lot of extra water. Let's move it off. Let's build some storage. Let's so we can have some certainty in our future. And I think this year is a good example, watching this water flow down the rivers. Everybody thought we're in a drought forever, and those times were never going to come back. And now we're finding out where some crops are planted that, hey, you know, it does flood once in a while, and maybe that's not such a good idea.
Yeah. Did you guys want to comment? Otherwise, I'll take the question from Stuart.
Okay, so I had a question, well, a comment for Michelle. I think you have a tall order, because if you want to go out and create this win-win where growers that have lost their water and now have land, you know, a lot of those guys don't trust government. They feel like they've had the rug pulled out from under them. And if you were to tell me, well, you know, if you created habitat and had some endangered species and what have you, I personally don't see the real direct benefit. I guess I don't understand. In our area, all the local kids go through the arroyos and stuff with their 22s and shoot anything that moves. So if we were to actually put up some land, I think we may get more of the same. So I think it's tough to go out and convince people that have lost a lot of their livelihood that now we're here to help you create more lizards, rats, burrowing animals, and then we may use it to flood. I don't understand that. If you had burrowing endangered species that we could then recharge out there, it seems to me there's kind of dual priorities.
Absolutely. It certainly wouldn't be an easy thing to do by any means. And if you were talking, you know, long-term fallowing of lands, I think that there would have to be incentives for folks to do that, and financial incentives. I mean, let's just be honest. There would have to be a benefit. So essentially, they're, instead of growing alfalfa or cotton, they're growing habitat. And so that's the kind of, you know, regulatory change or institutional change that we need to, I think, push for, so that, somebody that previously farmed a traditional agricultural crop can see the value of taking that land that, you know, frankly, based on the look of the, the way the region is looking to balance their supply and demand and recharge groundwater, some of that land is going to have to come out of production. So it might be that the districts themselves are the ones providing a financial incentive or contributing to it. I don't think it would just come from the state or federal government, though certainly, you know, those folks should be on board. I mean, those are the entities that are regulating for threatened and endangered species. And so there has to be something in it, obviously, for the folks that are on the ground. And again, I think, you know, going back to my message of reconnecting with the land, there's inherent value to that. And when I've worked with farmers on the land, which I have done, in fact, with a land retirement program many years ago, simply putting in a hedgerow and seeing the return of pheasants was life transforming for the one particular gentleman that I worked with. And he had kind of forgotten what it was like to have nature on the land in amongst where he was growing food and crops. So I think that could ultimately be seen as a benefit for folks along with financial incentives. Now, with regard to flooding land where you might have burrowing animals, that's an excellent point. And that's where we need to be strategic about what we do with land. That's the land use component. Definitely we need to be engaging with folks doing general plan updates, which tend to have a, you know, 20 or 30 year time horizon, to make sure that good choices are made in that regard. So you can deal with the issue of having burrowing animals potentially on an area that gets flooded by providing some high ground for them, understanding the topography of the land, making sure that they have what's called refugia, or areas to retreat to when the floodwaters come. That's part of the historical ecology of the valley. That's what those species are adapted for. But if you don't have pockets where they can hang on and then recolonize the natural areas when the floodwaters or the recharge waters recede, that's where you get local extinctions, and that's where you get species listings and so forth. So it's a matter of having the biologist and ecologist at the table for that planning of those sorts of projects, so that you can benefit the species, make sure they have a place for whatever circumstance might happen, you know, whether it's intentional flooding or accidental flooding from a levee break, right? And make sure that they can persist in the long run, which provides a safeguard that, you know, would preclude negative action against them. So, but it's definitely not an easy situation, I agree.
We have a question over here.
Nobody saw that, right? okay, so hi, my name is Pedro. I'm with the Leadership Council for Justice and Accountability. And I was just hoping if the panel can speak on some best practices in incorporating everyday people, you know, people that are not part of the alphabet soup of the agencies that we've been talking about. So again, I'm just wondering if there are some best practices specifically that, you know, people here in this room and people watching the replays of this video can take and implement more, you know, tomorrow or hypothetically.
So, excellent question. Who wants to go first? Go for it, Maria.
Well, first of all, I would say, you know, the studies that I mentioned earlier, the Tulare Lake Basin study, the Kings Basin DAC study, both of those, and in particular, the Kings Basin DAC study looked at sort of lesson learned and how do you educate communities and what are some of the strategies you should use to improve participation in the Integrated Regional Water Management Program. And so there are those two studies that list that, but I would sort of name a few. One of the things that we learned a lot is, you know, similar to how the comment that was made earlier about farmers not trusting the government, you know, there's also, you know, who your messenger is very important. And so what we found is that it's really important for some of these agencies, these groups, to partner with some of the local NGOs that have the relationships in the communities. Utilize them to get your message out there, to do the outreach, to do some of the education so that they can, you know, come through the door, sit at the table, and start engaging in these efforts. We learned that, you know, relationships matter. There's a lot of challenges in these communities. They don't have access to internet, email. And so, you know, you really do have to do that door-to-door, that outreach. And you also have to create opportunities for communities to work together to represent a common interest. There's just a lot of communities, and it's just not feasible to expect, you know, each of these districts to send somebody to these meetings. In the Kings Basin study, we found like there was over 100 communities just in the that IRWM group's planning area. And so we, even just to conduct the study, we sort of broke out the region in five sections, and we sort of had regional meetings in order to be able to reach as many communities. And so I think, you know, it is going to, communities will have to coordinate and look at ways to represent common interests in some of these discussions.
There was a question in the middle of the room.
Hi, I'm Julie Vance of the California Department of Fish and Wildlife. I wanted to add a little bit to the habitat value and flooding discussion. I think some people here know this, but I just wanted to be explicit about this. Habitat does have value and monetary value for landowners. I think some people are thinking, why would I want to do that other than the intrinsic value, and that's great, but I have other problems to worry about. You know, there are a number of project proponents that we're always dealing with at any given time that need to purchase either habitat credits or place a conservation easement on habitat, and they are looking for somewhere to spend money and find that acreage. And you know, there is a finite amount of acreage in the San Joaquin Valley, and we're getting to a point where it's getting harder and harder to find those things, and I think we're gonna have to really rely on more restored habitats that link up corridors and that are adjacent to other intact forms of habitat. So there is a significant financial incentive for landowners that want to do that, and it could at the same time benefit the groundwater woes that we're struggling with. One example, the flooding versus upland, you know, aquatic habitat versus upland. Like Michelle mentioned, the San Joaquin Valley used to be a series of wetlands with sort of upland fringe. The upland is where a lot of the listed species would have occurred. The sort of wetland is where we would have had more aquatic species like ducks, waterfowl, and so on. We can get to a place where we have a mosaic along those lines again. One sort of artificial example, but I think a successful example, is the Kern Water Bank. They've been water banking water down in the Kern County for quite some time. They take in a lot of water when water is available, and there's also quite a bit of the water bank that provides upland habitat, and they actually sell mitigation credits and are quite successful financially at doing so. So I think we need to do more of that.
You know, back to the previous question, I think trust is a is a big issue that we have also in some of this public dialogue. We're trying to find what the issues are, what the problems is. The industry's working with tri-colored blackbird, I think, for example. Once we understood what the problem was, they have different nesting areas, and they nest right in the middle of a field of wheat or some sort of crop we have. And it matters, understanding that, you can now look, okay, we got a problem, we got a nesting area. How do we work around that? Maybe we can help subsidize this guy so he doesn't have to harvest his crop. They can hatch and move along their way, and we can continue on our business practices. But if it's, I got these nesters out here, I better kill them before somebody finds out, because they're going to find me for something. But it's back to that trust. How can we work together? Do we really want to solve a problem, or are we out there just to create an issue? So I think the more we can work together and say, hey, come to the table, put our issues on the table and say, okay, I don't want to attack the issue, I want to attack the problem. So the minute we have our arms around that issue, we're going to try to protect that. So I try to, with the folks I work with, okay, let's put the issue out there. If we can beat it up, after we're through beating up that issue, we can take our arms around it and take care of it. But I don't have to attack you to solve that issue.
Thank you, Chuck. On that note, I'm being told that lunch is ready. Let's give our excellent panel a hand. And great questions from the audience. Thank you. And we will be back with our last panel at 12:15. Enjoy your lunch.